Hey everybody, Wyatt-Andrews-Workshop here, and welcome back to another episode of Orewell Zoo. Today we're going to be checking out the Primate House and the accompanying exhibits that will be over there. We'll check those out in a bit, but yeah, I just say we get right into it. So for context of where we are in Orewell Zoo, I feel like we've seen the Primate House multiple times in our little overviews at the end of our episodes, but it is right next to the elephant yard and just north of the sort of central clock tower pavilion. And then last episode, we looked at the desert dome over there. Again, check out that episode if you haven't already. See what my buddy Juno did. And then we have the giraffes over there. We're gonna have this sort of African grassland section extend all the way over there. But this is more the kind of African rainforest sort of section. It's not like the official African rainforest section, because I feel like we'll have more sort of forest animals in the Africa section in the future, but it's definitely up to sort of what I'm feeling like putting down at the time. So yeah, we'll go inside first, check it out. I built this all the way back in November, with sort of the other exhibits, main exhibits in the zoo, like the elephants and the entrance building I did back in December, the clock tower I did in November, and I'm trying to think what else I did. Everything else is pretty much brand new, because a lot of the stuff in November wasn't really like sort of up to my current standards, so I ended up either revising or deleting it. And then the reptile house I also started back in December, and I haven't really touched it since, so that may be something we do in a future episode. But yeah, we'll head inside the primate house. We got this really neat abstract gorilla statue. This is definitely one of my favorite statues in the game. I pretty much use it every time I build a gorilla exhibit, which is kind of teasing what we've got going on over there. But yeah, let's head in. So first we got this nice little cladogram. I actually built this for the primate house specifically, but I used it in Thornton Hill Zoo as well, in the orangutan exhibit I built for Drew. And yeah, over here we have the indoor room for some red ruff lemurs. It looks like they've sort of kind of bred unchecked, because at one point there were like 30 of them in here. But something I'm like over the moon about is how much they use the climbing structures. Like look at them go. I was not expecting them to use it this much. Like, of course it's still a little wonky, but I really can't be bothered as long as they're using it. It's such a cool thing to see. And then something you'll notice is like the sort of minimal signage I'm using in this, because I'm thinking this building was built in like the 60s or 70s, I'm not really sure. I'm trying to go for the vibe of either decade, really. Just that kind of sort of retro futuristic glass pavilion, but not too much like brick or anything like that. A lot of like plaster and really stark washed out color palette. But yeah, that's definitely the vibe I'm going for. And my key reference for this was actually the, I think it's the S.C. Johnson Tropical Discovery at the Cincinnati Zoo. I was going to say National Zoo, it's the Cincinnati Zoo. Specifically this sort of entrance portion, because I was looking at it and I thought the big glass part was this like big kind of like quarter circle thing, but it's actually like a cylinder. I was just looking at that one image and I kind of messed up the perspective, but I ended up getting something I really, really like, and it's like more or less like kind of original. So yeah, I really love how this came out. Heading back inside the primate house, we'll look at the second exhibit we've got in here. This is for mandrill. They always look so sad when they're sleeping. They look so miserable. They're fine. It's fine. but yeah, this isn't actually the only space they have, because they can come out here, and they both have outdoor cages. My mouse is getting caught in the desk, whatever. But yeah, they also come out here pretty frequently. I really loved how these climbing structures came out. I relied a lot more heavily on the bamboo and some of the thinner planks, and I didn't really feel like making ropes, or I didn't feel like putting down the in-game ropes we have. So I made my own out of the wooden planks. I just kind of spun them around to get specific like curves, and from a distance it looks pretty good. It looks really convincing. And then here's the outdoor bit for the mandrills. Just because they're larger monkeys, I sort of opted to use sort of thicker beams and planks, just so it'd be easier for them to kind of move around. They don't use it nearly as much as the lemurs, but as you can see, they do come up. They do use the climbing structure every once in a while. And then on the outside part, originally I'd used just Goron's aviary set to make the outdoor cages, but this isn't a knock against Goron at all. But I just didn't really like they just didn't really fit in the area, so I ended up making my own out of the trim pieces, the roof trim pieces, and then I used the hanging lamps for the cables, and I think it's a really unique look that much better complements the shape of the glass dome thing. It's not really a dome, I guess it's just a big glass structure, but it's kind of that quarter circle, again, sort of assigning a specific shape language to the area that I really like. And then continuing some of the object palette I've been using for Orewell, I have these little flower bench planter things that have kind of sprinkled around. And then this is a sweet treats booth. I figured they'd have ice cream and stuff in here. But I didn't actually make this. Eben made this. He put it in Tharmashadi. But when I was done, he said Goron and I could borrow any blueprints we needed or wanted from the park. And he is so good at these little booths, and I just had to pick up a couple of them because they're so fantastic. And I switched the colors around and added my own sign just to sort of make it my own. And then I borrowed the queue railing thing and the carpets from the Jash's tiny frozen ball stand. And I think it adds so much life to the area because zoos don't just have restaurants. They are chock full of like snack stands and like ices and Dippin' Dot stands. And it was definitely missing from Orwell, that specific bit of zoo, sort of that zoo vibe, you know? All right. And then these banners carried over from the elephants, the banners that are used for the elephant section. I'm thinking I'll sort of spread these around. I'll have like one for the giraffes, or maybe just one for the Africa section, and one for the Indo-Malaya section. But I do think it unifies each area really nicely. Alright, so we'll go back to the other side, because the other side of the primate house is pretty much identical, but it's a lot less developed, so we won't really look at that yet. And then I wanted to point out how much more I've been using the flowers recently. We'll actually go down to the clock tower, because I regardened the base of it, because before it was just like a lot of generic green shrubbery and then some of the azalea flowers. And I feel like I've gotten a lot braver with my sort of colors, both in sort of architecture and landscaping. Before, I was just sort of a lot less confident with my colors, but now got these like insane neon yellows and reds and purples, and I just think they help stand out, or they pop really well, and they help specific areas of the zoo stand out. Like I won't be extending like this flower palette all the way over the zoo, because that would be extremely expensive, but like, you know, specific areas like the clock tower and like entrances to specific sections like you see here. And then we will go out over here to the Riverside Bar and Grill. I mentioned in the elephant episode that I wanted to have a restaurant here, and here it is. I've sort of continued the flowers. I think this is actually where I originated my sort of flower color palette, my sort of optics palette for the area. And I sort of began extending it across to the other areas of the zoo. But yeah, I freaking love how this came out. This may very well be my favorite restaurant that I've built in the game. I love, love, love how it came out. It has such sort of old-timey, idealistic zoo vibes. Like, this is the kind of thing you'd see at, like, the Lincoln Park Zoo or the Central Park Zoo. Just that kind of sort of brick and, like, metal roofs that... I used a lot of the classical pieces for this, which you really shouldn't sleep on if you're trying to do a zoo in the U.S., at least, because they are... they're perfect for nailing that kind of old-timey look. It gives a lot of age to your zoo. And then this specific roof technique I borrowed from Rubel. I didn't blueprint his specific ticket booth, but I went back into the Tivoli map to see how he did it. And he used let me see how he did this. So the rectangles, you form the triangle with the rectangles, but then when it gets to that corner, you can't use rectangles anymore. So you have to use the half circle, and it's a brilliant technique that I never would have come up with myself. So thank you, Rubel, for inventing that and letting me steal your technique there. And over here we've got some more benches with my custom folded umbrellas that you can get on the workshop. Just look that up. And then I built this bathroom because Orewell didn't really have nearly enough bathrooms. The only other one I have is down by the seal exhibit. So I figured I would probably want to start spreading more of these around for the sake of my guests. I won't be opening the zoo for the in-game people, but, I'm just thinking practically. He brought over my little custom, my little men and women signs for the different bathrooms, and then, I looked up, Central Park bathroom, because, that sort of architectural style with the brick, is really appealing to me, and the sort of, metal-clad roofs with the little ridges on them, and I didn't find one from Central Park, but I did find one that I really, really liked, so I more or less copied it and added sort of my own different, like, color palette and different textures just to better suit it to Orwell's sort of vibe, you know? And then, I haven't done anything with the interior of this, so I will likely be adding kitchens and cashiers, and then, this is probably where a full kitchen would be. I have doors leading out here to this little backstage area, and I used Jash's trash container thing. It's just a trash container. It looks fantastic, though. And then I'm not sure what I want to do with this area. I'm thinking one of two things. I'm thinking I'll have a fence just going right here, and I'll just have continued backstage stuff. Or I will have a second gift shop that I will cram into here, and guests can come access it from, like, right here. But, let me know what you think would be good here. Maybe even another, like, small exhibit, maybe, like, an aviary of some kind would be cool here. And then, I brought over my sort of, lamppost hanger things with the different animal banners. And then, something I really love about this build is the, elevation change. I based this sort of layout directly on a restaurant at the Lincoln Park Zoo, and especially this, like, central rotunda spire thing. But their version is, like, completely flat, but, I opted to raise mine up, just a little, and then you have these little brick paths leading you up here, and I just think, it adds a lot to the composition, especially, like, right here. It looks fantastic. And then, the sweet treats, I brought over another sweet treats booth in Tharmashadi. I edited this one a lot. I had to add a little cash register, and then I added a vending machine for the staff to put Icy in. I think the Icy logo is what really ties this all together, because you see this all the time at zoos in the U.S. Just Icy and Dippin' Dots and other different brands of sweets, like, all over the place. So it's definitely adding a lot. And then another thing I really love about this area is the brick trim I've added to all of the pathing. And then I added the little herringbone path in little sort of access points for guests to come up to the restaurant and bathroom. I just think it adds, like, a whole nother level of texture to the area. And I won't be continuing it all the way down for obvious reasons. The terrain in this map is super wonky, and I do not feel like adding, like, brick, like, rimming all the way down this hill and just all over the place. But, you know, in, like, little areas like this where it gets a little more classical, it definitely helps add to the atmosphere. And let's talk about the elephant in the room. This elephant statue was brought to you by Leaf and the Lion Rider because they are working on a safari pack. It's going to have a bunch of different animals, many of which are already on the Nexus site. But it's also going to have over 200 different scenery items, including this elephant statue, which they very graciously let me beta test. They've given me access to the safari pack beforehand just to sort of like look for bugs and stuff like that and just sort of make use of the pieces. And it has been fantastic so far. They've done an excellent job. So definitely stay tuned for that. It should be out very soon in the next month or so. And yeah, before we move into the... before what's going on the left side, I wanted to point out that I replaced the fence for the entrance of the Elephant Community Center, because before it was this really ugly wooden sort of rustic fence, and it just didn't fit at all with the area. And you can see I'm doing some renovation over there in that viewing area, but I really want to sort of like strengthen the like zoo's color palette, really solidify it. To the point where I've done some repainting on the Elephant Community Center. I forgot that one. I forgot to repaint that one. It's fine. But yeah, the before, you can actually see it was this color. And then I repainted the roof. It was a huge pain in the ass because of all of these different little triangle, or not triangle, rectangle pieces. Before it was a lot more bland. But zooming out, the zoo's sort of like intense blue roofs for all of the different buildings it's really helped make everything pop a lot more, as well as the reds and the blue and the kind of almost pinkish red. It's more of a salmon color, but I really, really love it up against this sort of turquoise aquamarine color for some of the other roofs in the zoo back towards the entrance, as well as the all of this trim on the side of the building. It's looking real fresh. And then, yeah, we'll move into sort of the main focus of the episode, which is the Gorilla Canyon, brought to you by U.S. Bank. I just looked at the U.S. Bank logo, and I think it is a really nice sort of cherry on top. Zoos do corporate sponsors all the time. I noticed U.S. Bank does it pretty frequently, so yeah, thought it worked. So yeah, this is the Gorilla Canyon. It functions as the zoo's African rainforest section. As you can see, we got gorillas, and then we got colobuses, which is going to be another animal in the safari pack, and they made a little sign for this. I think the signs in the safari pack, you'll see more of these as we go through this, but I think the signs are easily one of my favorite parts of it. They add so much, and I can't wait to see what else they add. And it's also kind of inspired me. I may want to... start making my own scenery mods, just sort of draw some animals and turn them into signs for specific things I need. It's really gotten a lot of gears turning in my head. Super exciting for the sort of feature of the game once Frontier is done making DLCs, which won't be for another year or so, but still. So yeah, into the sort of entrance plaza of the Gorilla Canyon, we have these sort of spinning info signs. These were directly ripped from the Congo Gorilla Forest at Bronx Zoo. I'm not sure what's on them. It's just sort of generic info and like animal signs and stuff like that, but you can sort of spin them around and they're on different sides, and I thought it looked really neat. And then over here, this is another part of the safari pack, this sort of topographical map of Africa. We have a little sign talking about how Africa has been more sort of well-studied and understood over the years, whereas before it was sort of the colonial perspective. Oh, it's the Dark Continent. It's so mysterious and foreign. But sort of the goal of this is to kind of help people understand sort of where we are in terms of relations with the continent of Africa these days. All right, and then moving through, we have our first exhibit for the Red River Hog. So for the safari pack, it's consisting of several animals that are already on the, Steam Workshop, it's the Nexus website, but they're also adding several brand new ones specifically for the safari pack, and one of them is the Red River Hog, but they aren't done with it yet, so I'm using the Common Warthog. However, I did install a Warthog Remaster, I guess is what it's called. That makes them a little more gray, adds a lot more texture to the model, which I guess isn't necessarily more accurate, But, like, you can see, like, the variation. This one is a lot more, it's almost greener. And then this one is a lot more, like, a paler, warmer, or cooler gray. And I think that variation definitely helps add a lot of realism that wasn't there before. Now we just have to figure out how to add manes to these guys, because, like I mentioned in the animal tier list, warthogs have some pretty ridiculous manes that the Planet Zoo model wasn't really able to render. But yeah, they've got a little musty little pool. It's definitely on the smaller side, but it is sort of an intro exhibit, so you're just sort of meant to look at this for a little bit and then move on. But I do think it looks really nice. It's really nice and simple. And then turning around, we have the main attraction of the Gorilla Canyon, the gorillas themselves. We have a massive exhibit for these guys, which I actually forgot to look at in the Primate House. Let's go check that out. Hold on. I forgot to look at their indoor yard, their room in the Primate House. So yeah, this is where you can see the gorillas first, assuming you're coming to the zoo in this order, or you're going through the zoo in this order. I think it's a zoo in Germany. I'll put a picture up to show you what my reference was, but it was a really neat sort of indoor gorilla area that gave me a lot of ideas as to sort of what their climbing structures are supposed to look like. You'll notice, like, with the mandrills, I added, like, thicker beams compared to the lemurs, where it's, like, a lot of bamboo and ropes. Where these guys, it's just, like, straight-up logs and beams, because obviously these guys weigh, like, 400 pounds, so they're obviously not gonna be, like, swinging around on, like, thin branches and stuff like that. And then there are these, like, really cool, like, support beams, or, like, support, like, brackets for the logs to come through, and I think it looks really, really neat. They obviously don't use it at all, because, you know, Frontier, but, they do actually come up here. They climb these ladders, as you might have noticed when we were walking in, and they come into the gorilla yard. I love this so much. Hold on, let me adjust the lighting. Boom, look at that. This is far and away my favorite primate habitat that I've built in the game. The logs, the like mud walls. I want to talk about the mud walls. So these are made of the trunks we got in the aquatic pack, and as well as these baobab trunks. You'll notice they're a little lower res, but I think like they really help break up the repetition of the aquatic pack trunks, the baobab trunks we got in the safari pack. But yeah, and then I sprinkled some of the other faux rocks in just to kind of help break up that texture a little. And when you just step back and look at it, it's perfect. I'm madly in love with how this habitat came out. It is, yeah, like I mentioned, far and away my favorite gorilla habitat, or just primate habitat in general that I've made. And definitely in like my top five favorite habitats that I've built. If you're sort of a, like even like surface level zoo nerds will notice the sort of reference and inspiration from the Houston Zoo specifically. They have a lot of these mud walls, and then they have this sort of lower level where it's just rock, and they have these logs that the gorillas can use to come down and traverse all over the place. The babies are definitely more exploratory than the adults. Where did that one go? He escaped. That's nice. Okay, we'll deal with him later. I haven't really ironed out all of the kinks yet, but I wanted to get an episode out sooner than later, so it's pretty much done. It's in its like final stages. But yeah, the gorillas like use the logs, they climb around, it looks fantastic. I wish they would come down here more, though it's mostly just the babies that come down here because the adults don't really climb as much for some weird dumb reason. Like I don't get it. I talked about this in the Tivoli video with Ruble, but for some reason the babies are just like way more agile and like they climb around a lot more and just do more things than the adults do. It's dumb. They could literally just program the adults to do the exact same thing, but they don't. So yeah, you'll notice in the sort of places where the guests are meant to see, it's a lot more manicured, there's a lot more of the artificial rock work, but then as you move in, this is just like straight up natural forest. They did like nothing to this besides like maybe getting rid of some plants that the gorillas wouldn't be safe to consume. But yeah, I opted to make this as like natural looking as possible, so you have like actual like dead trees and like pebbles and stones, different kinds of plants. I have a pretty consistent plant palette for Orwell, but I pretty much threw that out the window when doing this part because you've got like ferns and brambles and all of these like gnarly, sort of much less manicured landscaping than as you sort of get out here, and it's a lot more artificial looking, but still, it still looks really good. But yeah, we'll head back onto the actual trail where we're meant to be, and we'll check out the gorillas from there. So it looks like they've all completely moved on, but this is sort of your first window into the gorilla habitat. Oh, there's one. We got a nice female there. We've got more of these logs, and it's a little annoying because the log sort of trunk things are, I guess, registered as climbable objects, so sometimes the gorillas do phase through the wall. But as long as you put out like rocks and sort of the elephant grass, they don't seem to do it as much, so it's fine. But yeah, I've got a water bowl, so they come down here super frequently just to get a drink, and it complements the whole area really nicely. I'm just like googling over the mud walls I did for this whole area just because they add so much. And I want to shout out Mario19 on BroNation because he invented this technique, and just so many props to him because this area would not have been nearly as it wouldn't have turned out nearly as well without him, without what he created for that. So big shout out to Mario there. All right, and then moving through the trail, these log fences or these like the stick fences are from the safari pack. Definitely another really nice addition. We have our second exhibit for the okapi, another fantastic sign from the safari pack. But yeah, there they are. We got a nice sizable yard for these fellas. I really love how this came out. I love the sort of more subdued sort of mud wall that sort of loops around. It's a lot less sort of apparent than like when you go to the gorillas and it is just like this towering, like almost mountainous kind of landscaping. This is a lot more subdued and something you see in a lot of like semi-modern upstock yards, and that's the kind of look I'm going for, like semi-modern. Like it's not like ultra modern. Like I think ultra modern is like 2015 onwards. This is definitely like pre-2010 kind of look I'm going for, where like the sort of African theming is still really vague. They're not really trying to like educate visitors about like the specific locations these animals are found in. It's just kind of Africa, you know? But it's definitely a step in the right direction. And then we have these little shade canopy things that I made out of the Indian fabric. This was kind of an unexpected piece because I've always been using the banners for my shade structures. Well, let me find an example. Yeah, so over here for the elephants, I've been using these banners that have like leopard or zebra print, and I've just been coloring them uniform, and that's sort of the main technique I've been using for these banners. But definitely don't sleep on the Indian like fabric drapery because it is extremely versatile for any sort of shade structure, just sort of when you're trying to make like a when you're trying to make like an interior more visually busy, just like sort of hang these over, and they have like a really nice rustic, I don't want to say exotic, but it definitely helped make it feel sort of more quote unquote adventurous. And we have these lights that I didn't borrow these directly from Tivoli, but it was inspired by the technique I used, where it's kind of a metal pole, and then it goes up. And then there's a that attaches to an even larger wooden pole, and then those are tied together, and then there's a plaster base at the bottom. It's a really neat sort of rustic lantern. And then for the okapi exhibit, I used these little hardy sort of palms by duct tape for his desert flora set, and then I made a custom tree out of the eucalyptus, or not eucalyptus, acacia saplings, and it looks really cool. I love the tons of branches poking out of the greenery. It's a really neat look. And then we get into our second viewing plaza for the gorillas. This is the main look into their main yard. There we go. So yeah, you see pretty much everything from here. even like sort of all three levels of the exhibit that are only used by the babies, but still, I really, really love like this view especially. It's fantastic. And I love how you can see the primate house kind of poking out back there. Just thought it was a really neat touch. You used to be able to see the clock tower, but I think all of the massive trees that I've thrown in have kind of blocked that off, but that's fine. And then we have these gorilla signs from the safari pack. I think these are meant to be mountain gorillas because they're planning on adding mountain gorillas, which are not in captivity, but that's fine. These are still extremely useful just for any gorilla exhibit you're making. And then continuing my reference at the Houston Zoo, this sort of viewing shelter thing was directly ripped from that, with the fans and everything and the sort of form factor of the support beams. All right, and then moving through, you get one last look at the okapis. I wanted to kind of semi-obscure the view of the okapis a little bit, just because they are pretty shy animals, but it's not to the point where they're, like, difficult to see. You can still see them just fine, but there's, like, a ton of greenery up front just so the okapis can hide if need be. All right, moving through, after you get that one last look, we get into... Oh, perfect timing, asshole. Look at you go. Wow. Thanks. Gee, thanks. But yeah, this is the Angolan colobus exhibit. Like I mentioned before, they're going to have colobuses, but I've been using the female proboscis monkeys for now, which I assume is what they're going to model it off of, because it's a much better base than the capuchin monkey, which is a New World monkey that has like a really curly prehensile tail. Okay. But as you can see, they use the climbing structure pretty frequently. Look at them going across the ropes there. And what I really love about this habitat is that you can't see the bottom at all. Like, whenever the monkeys go down, they just appear to descend beneath the tree line, and it appears like you're in the forest canopy with them, and it's like a super... It's super immersive, and I directly ripped this from the San Diego Zoo's colobus habitat. All the way down to these support beams on each corner that have like these little I don't know what these are called. I guess like cables that just kind of support the beam, make sure it doesn't like fall over. And then I have these lamps that I guess are for the staff and they need to come up and do maintenance like at night, I guess. Oh wow, this didn't happen before. They weren't able to come up on the top of this, but I guess they just decided to ruin my video. So, you know, thanks for that. But, you know, it's fine. They're moving around. It looks cool. And, yeah, I haven't done anything over here yet. I don't really plan to add any exhibits. Just kind of a natural trail. Oh, look, another gorilla escaped. We're having a great episode. The gang's all here. Everyone is in their places. But, yeah, we'll kind of go over the gorilla area again. I was really kind of poring over, like, do I want to have, like, a sort of, like, shade boma thing over here? Like, a really big shade structure. But, like, I kept adding the different versions of it, and it just didn't look very good. I really loved the kind of openness of it. Like, this sort of, like, circle plaza thing, like, really pops out of all of the greenery. Oh yeah, and then the backstage area for the Okapi and Red River Hog. So the hogs have this whole building to themselves. I figure there would be more staff facilities in here. And then the Okapis have this barn, and then they can come through here, and then they can come out over here. And this is sort of a like secondary isolation yard, just in case they need to be sort of extended out of the view of guests. And then I downloaded a cinder block texture online and used it for the wall. It works like it works when you look at it head on, just because there's no like sort of ambient lighting obscuring the flat texture. But it gets a little wonky when you're from here and it starts to just kind of fade away. But when you're up close, I think it looks great, and that's usually where I am, so it's fine. And yeah, that was the Gorilla Canyon / Primate House section. As you can see, I've got some stuff going on over there. We'll be slowly working on that. And then, let's see what else we got going on. I have like a kind of radial design plan for the sort of outside bit of the desert house, and it's just kind of up to me to fill up that section. And I've also been hard at work on the Indo-Malaya building. It'll have orangutans and a few other rotational exhibits there, so that'll be pretty exciting. So yeah, definitely more Orewell stuff coming soon, now that I'm pretty amped up on what I've got going on here. It's been pretty motivating to see people enjoying everything I've been doing. And I just wanted to thank you guys for the sort of really continued support of the channel. So I will see you in whatever comes first, and have a good one.